The long-awaited static fire test for spacecraft 37 is finally underway. Everyone is excited, but when will it actually happen? Meanwhile, B-13 has returned home, and it's preparing for its next adventure. The Falcon 9 mission was delayed due to a power outage. Europe has completed a parachute test for its Mars landing. This is a crucial step in exploring other planets. Let's discuss it all in today's episode of NR Studio. It's almost the end of July, and we're getting ready for Flight 10. One of the most exciting things coming up is the static fire test for spacecraft 37. Recent progress updates provide a general overview of its progress, but the official test schedule provides real clarity. Fortunately, we now have that. A new beach closure has been announced for Boca Chica on July 29th. The exact time of the closure is not yet known, but it will take place early next week. This aligns with plans for a major test event. Typically, when a closure like this occurs, it means something significant is happening at the launch site. This could be the test stand on Pad A, where SpaceX has just finished installing a new test system. The question now is which prototype will be tested during this time. Currently, there are two candidates, Ship 37 and Ship 38. 37 is the primary choice for the static fire test. The engines have been installed, the cowlings have been attached, and other important steps have been completed. This means the ship is nearly ready for final preparations. Ship 38, on the other hand, is preparing for cryogenic testing. Recent images show that work is still underway on the nose cone, which appears to involve tasks related to the heat shield. The removal of scaffolding around the spacecraft indicates that the spacecraft is nearly complete. SpaceX has a good plan in choosing Ship 38 for the first test. Conducting cryogenic testing before a static fire can help verify how well the new test system works and ensure it is safe. Such a test would help engineers verify that the hardware is ready in a safer situation before using it with the intense power of a real engine ignition. I still believe this upcoming shutdown means there will be a static fire test for Ship 37. Both Musk and previous FCC filings estimated that Flight 10 might occur in early August. With it being almost the end of July, we are running out of time. Further delays could jeopardize that launch window. Furthermore, some believe that intensive system testing may be unnecessary. The orbital launch mount has demonstrated that it can handle the forces of a full-scale booster test and launch. A ship-level static fire, which generates significantly less power, should be safely within its operational limits.
The ship's new quick disconnect system and improved piping build on the proven OLM design. The water deluge system will draw water directly from a sturdy platform beneath the cradle. The only potential issue is how well the new and existing systems work together. However, this is still feasible, especially considering how quickly SpaceX has made changes and been able to refine them over time. If the static test goes according to plan, there will be more testing to look forward to. Based on past trends, S-37 will likely undergo several tests. These tests could include a short single-engine test run followed by a longer run where all engines fire simultaneously for up to a minute. These tests are crucial not only for flight readiness, but also for pushing the vehicle to its limits and discovering any hidden issues early on. Moving forward, there are still several steps to complete to stay on track. Final connections need to be made to the piping at the test site. These pipes will need to be connected to the ship's quick disconnect panel. At the same time, S-37 will be thoroughly inspected to ensure everything is functioning properly before it can be moved. As for transportation, the stands needed to move the 37-foot booster need to be moved to Megabate 2 for launch. All of this work is expected to be completed in the next few days, leading up to one of the most important and exciting weeks of the Starship program. Are you ready for the next big test? If so, comment "Let's do it" below. Don't forget to like the video and subscribe to our channel to stay updated on every part of SpaceX's amazing journey. Let's focus on other important Starship information. The stunning return of B-13 still impacts Starship's future. The rear section of the booster, featuring three prominent engine mounting spikes, has officially arrived at the port of Brownsville after being lifted from the seabed. New photos show the condition of the booster while it was at sea, giving us a rare glimpse into what happened after landing. This section is being prepared for transfer to SpaceX's Starbase facility. Roads will be closed from midnight to 4 a.m. As of July 23rd, plans were in place to facilitate this transfer. This means the booster is likely already en route or undergoing a thorough inspection. While we've discussed its condition, what matters most is what happens next. When they arrive at Starbase, engineers will thoroughly examine the structure. Salvageable parts will likely be reused or inspected, while fragments will help refine the design. These findings are crucial for understanding what the booster experienced during its flight, descent, and landing. The lessons learned from B-13 will be crucial for the next 10 flights, which will include B-16. Future launches will present new challenges, such as complex flips and sharper landings.
After its 10th flight, the B-13 recovery is part of the larger Starship development. Inside Megabay, construction on the V-3 design is already underway. This version includes refinements based on lessons learned from flights like this one. Each recovered piece of hardware has its own story, and that story may be crucial to Starbase's goal of full reusability and mission success. Now let's discuss another important update. A Falcon 9 mission was recently abruptly canceled. The Falcon 9 rocket launched with several scientific instruments, including NASA's Tracer satellite. The cancellation came just 45 seconds before launch. The mission was part of SpaceX's ride-sharing program and was supposed to launch from Vandenberg Space Force Base. However, the launch was halted because the FAA declared it unfeasible. A power outage in Santa Barbara caused communication problems at the Los Angeles Air Traffic Control Center, which manages flight paths over the Pacific. The FAA delayed the launch to maintain airspace safety. While rare, this situation demonstrates how much space travel relies on support from Earth. SpaceX said there has been a delay and has moved the launch to July 23rd at 11:13 a.m. Pacific Daylight Time. The mission will launch using the B-1081 booster of a Falcon 9 rocket, which will be flying for the 16th time. B-1081 has supported important missions such as NASA's Crew 7 and CRS-29. B-1081 will land at Landing Zone 4 shortly after launch. One of the key payloads on board is NASA's Tracer satellite. Under the Small Explorers program, the Tracers will study how the solar wind affects Earth's magnetic field. This research will help us understand space weather, which is crucial for satellite function, communications, and keeping astronauts safe. Other payloads include the PEX demo, Athena Epic, Real Skycraft 4, and LIID. These each support research in climate, Earth observation, and telecommunications. While this delay is surprising, it demonstrates the importance of flexibility in space travel today. Now that safety checks are complete and launch preparations are underway, the mission is poised to provide critical data that could inform the future of science and space exploration. Let's wrap up today's update and move a little closer to the North Pole, where a significant new development in Europe's Mars exploration program has occurred. In the Arctic, the European Space Agency, ESA, successfully tested a large parachute system at high altitude. This system is being prepared for the upcoming ExoMars mission. The ESA stated that this two-stage parachute system was designed to aid in the landing of scientific equipment on Mars. The system has two different parachutes. The first is 50 feet wide, or about 15 meters. The second is a very large one, measuring 118 feet wide, or about 35 meters. The ESA proudly announced that this is the largest parachute system ever built for use in space. It is designed to safely decelerate and land modules containing critical equipment on Mars. The parachute system has undergone a long and arduous development process. It has undergone numerous rigorous tests, including several failures. Despite these issues, the system was finally deemed ready for its maiden launch in 2022. Unfortunately, the mission was delayed due to political issues that arose after Russia invaded Ukraine. Because Russia provided the landing platform and other critical technology for the mission, the ESA was forced to withdraw from the partnership. Therefore, the parachutes were stored while Europe began building a new landing platform. Luca Ferracina, a systems engineer for the ESA's ExoMars landing module, said, "We were testing to make sure we were ready for Mars and to check if the parachutes still functioned well after being stored for so long. These Arctic tests appear to have demonstrated that the parachutes are ready." Meanwhile, the future of the ExoMars mission as a whole has been impacted by funding concerns. NASA was originally slated to provide hundreds of millions of dollars to help ESA with the mission. The Trump administration proposed a NASA budget that cuts funding for that as part of broader cuts to science. The U.S. Senate Appropriations Committee fortunately rejected the cuts in a report on Friday, July 18. This means Congress may still support NASA's work on ExoMars. The ESA is closely monitoring these developments because if NASA withdraws its support entirely, it could cause further delays to a mission that has already faced numerous delays. The ESA recently signed a $194 million deal with Airbus to build a new landing platform in Europe. During the parachute test, a model of the descent module was raised to an altitude of 18.6 miles, also known as 30 kilometers, with the help of a high-altitude balloon. The test took place at the Strange Space Center in Kiruna, Sweden. After about 20 seconds of freefall, the first parachute deployed.
This helped mimic the air forces the module would encounter as it descended through the thin Martian atmosphere. Mars has only about 1% the density of Earth's atmosphere. ESA engineers took great care to set the test conditions to match the speeds and environmental factors that would be present during a real landing. Ferracina said, "The speeds and thin air in this test are exactly what the parachutes would encounter on Mars. During a real landing on Mars, the capsule will enter the planet's atmosphere at a breakneck speed of 13,050 miles per hour, or about 21,000 kilometers per hour. Natural drag will slow the speed to about 1,000 miles per hour before the first parachute deploys. In the latest test, the mock capsule accelerated incredibly fast during a brief fall through Earth's stratosphere." Ferracina said, "We're very excited to announce that we have a parachute design that will work on Mars. It's a massive system with the largest parachute ever deployed outside Earth. Europe is clearly striving to become a strong player in the race to explore Mars. With this successful test, the ExoMars mission is making significant progress, and everyone will be eager to see what happens next." That's it for today's episode. See you in the next one.